Hello, I'm Mr. Arniger, a retired lecturer in mythology, preaching Christianity and Sikhism. Sikhism is continuation of Christianity, and the parables of the New Testament are on my fingertips. I can explain, but most people are believing in letters, dead letters, what is written in the Bible. They don't want to know what is hidden underneath. Remember that the treasures of our Father are buried in the field. They are not lying on the surface like the letters. On the surface are dead letters. Gospel is buried underneath. So unless you are capable of logical reasoning, you can't dig them out. And here I'm doing an exposition of Acts 13, verse 13 to 25. Then Paul and his companions set sail from Paphos and came to Perga in Pamphylia. John, however, left them and returned to Jerusalem. But they went on from Perga and came to Antioch in Pisidia. And on the Sabbath day, they went into the synagogue and sat down. After the reading of the law and the prophets, the officials of the synagogue sent them a message saying, "Brothers, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, give it." So Paul stood up and with a gesture began to speak. "You Israelites and others who fear God, listen. The God of this people, Israel, which is Yahweh, the demiurge of nature, who brought them and settled them into the promised land, chose our ancestors and made the people great during their stay in the land of Egypt." In the Egypt, they went to, you know, because the people of the Isaac, Jacob, remember, he had 12 sons, and of the 12, 11 were crook. Joseph was the only honest man who truthful. The crook brethren hated the honest man, Joseph. So they wanted to kill him. Instead of killing him, they sold him as a slave to the Egyptians. Being honest to God and honest to Abraham, he had all these spiritual virtues, gifts. And he then succeeded, and the Egyptian, being righteous people, they honored him, and they put him on the highest honor, highest post of honor. So this one is, you know, in the land of Egypt, refer to the parable of the prodigal son Isaac and his people, whilst the elder son of Abraham, Ishmael, stayed faithful to his father Abraham. For this reason, baby Jesus was sent to Egypt under the care of Saltful. Saltful means a person who have conscience, tribal conscience. Sons of Abraham, people in Egypt, to look after him while the cruel, arrogant Herod was ruling. You remember, light came among his own, and his own loved darkness. So when they loved darkness, so they did not want Christ to appear. And that's why they were instigating Herod, telling him everything, because they knew the Christ has come. And they knew, and they were instigating the stupid Herod, a cruel man. who were pleased when the temple priest told him to kill people. And so he was ruling. So he was, when he was baby, he was sent away into the safety of the Ishmael people, Egyptian. So cruel, arrogant, however, ruling, and with uplifted arm as the sign of surrender to Abraham, he led them out of it. You know, they became unfaithful to Abraham, and that is why they were thrown out of the promised land. 11 crook brothers, they have no sort of Abraham in them. They were not righteous people. They were crook. Only righteous person was Joseph, whose people are Samaritans. So when Joseph left, no righteous person left in the promised land, and promised land became totally barren, and they had to leave promised land for Egypt for their survival. And in Egypt, Joseph honored them and looked after them. But as the salt of the people were not there, so when they came back to the promised land, they kicked the Samaritans in their faces. They hated them. That is why in John 4, the Samaritan woman at the well said, "You Jew, you hate us, and you want water from me?" So that means their nature has not been gone. They were, that's why Jesus sitting in the temple after they had brought a woman caught in adultery, that would have produced a natural bastard. But Jesus belonged to our supernatural father, spiritual. So that was produced a physical bastard, which is next to nothing, you know, mustard seed. You remember the parable of the mustard seed? Mustard seeds are people who are born of the prostitutes or of the temple dancing girls. They have no right to occupy the secular property of Adam, no right to marriage or anything of that type, but to surrender their life to the worship of our Father God, which is Spirit, our supernatural Father. That is why they become big saint, and the birds of the air, sensible people, go and listen to their preaching, listen to their gospel delivered by them. Even Krishna in India, he went to the house of a person, Biddar was his name, and he went to his house to stay. Biddar was born of a dancing girl, so he had no right to occupy any land or get married. So he was a great saint. So Krishna went there to listen to him, because saints are greater than the prophets. So Krishna was nothing compared to the saint Biddar. So with this going a little bit astray, so Egypt and the care of Saltful sons of Abraham, the Abraham people, the Ishmaelite, to look after him while the cruel, arrogant Herod was ruling, and with uplifted arm as the sign of surrender to Abraham, Moses led them out of it. For about 40 years he put up with them in the wilderness, making them to eat the driest food, manna, as punishment. Remember Jesus when he fed the 5,000 people with the very tasty food as compared with manna. That food was supplied by the subservient Yahweh, the demiurge god of nature. Whatever you see in nature with two eyes, pot, these pots, all belong to Yahweh. So he is the one who bring in very tasty food for the 5,000 people, plenty of it. So there were 12 baskets left over. So Jesus then told them, you know, after making them eat well, telling them with the taste, you know, that if you are faithful to God, that is what you will be eating. Then he said, unless you eat the flesh of Jesus and drink the blood of Christ, you have no part in me. Now those people who are following Jesus, they were mostly Jewish people, of men of letters. Today you have university professors, men of letters. When he said, unless you eat the flesh of Jesus, they took literal sense. As Nicodemus took literal sense, shall I go back into the womb of my mother to be born again? Same way these people took literal sense. They said, hey, he's gone mad. He said, no, cut me in small pieces and eat me. No, 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 we are leaving him. They left him. And then Jesus turned around and told his 12 laborers. They were not disciples. The root of the word is discipline. You discipline natural boys. They were twice born, sensible people. So he turned around to his laborers, 12 laborers, asking them, do you want to leave me too? Then Peter, having tasted very tasty food, said, no, 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 we don't want to leave you. You have the bread of life. That means with that type of food, we can enjoy life. So he stayed behind. So in Jesus, we are solitary. Unless you are solitary, you can't enter that narrow gate that leads to salvation. Narrow gate leads to the vineyard of our Father, where the true vine, Christ Jesus, is planted. So you can't graft yourself to that true vine unless you are solitary, capable of entering into the vineyard through that narrow gate. Narrow gate is known to you by the grace of our Father. And when you enter that one, then you, if you are devoted to God, then you will graft yourself to the true vine, Christ Jesus, and eat the flesh of Jesus. Mean what came out of the mouth of Jesus, you should eat it with your ears. These are the mouth for the spiritual food. That's why Jesus said, let them hear who have ears. After eating with these ears, take it to your heart, digest it, and bring it from your own mouth. With authority, you digest it through logical reasoning. And with authority, you preach gospel in honor of Christ Jesus to glorify our Father God. We don't glorify Jesus, but our Father we glorify. Our Father is not a Lord. Lord has slaves. Slaves are not allowed into the house. So if you want to enter the house of our Father, you have to be sons of the Most High. So we are sons, as John's Gospel from states, that he came to make us the sons of the Most High. So manna as punishment, you know, he was given after he had destroyed seven nations. Seven are concerned with the physical self, temporal, not spiritual, temporal. In the land of Canaan, he gave them their lush, green, productive, promised land as an inheritance of their father Abraham for about 450 years. Remember the parable of the prodigal son? When the son came, father Abraham, because they were faithful to him, he killed the fattened calf to honor him, music, everything. He could entertain him. And that fattened calf is lush green promised land, which they had left as barren. You know, many people, they are scientists, you know, sometime I go to Oxford University, they come, scientists come there. I tell them, you know, this promised land, when the Jewish people are promised, these chosen people are faithful to Abraham, this promised land is lush green. And when they are unfaithful to Abraham, the same land becomes barren. Could science explain this one? They have no answer. So you see, the power of the God is supernatural, which is above nature. You can't study it like chemistry, physics in the universities or other thing. The knowledge of our supernatural Father is given by grace, and those who long for it, those who long, they seek. That's why Jesus said, ask, seek, and knock is the way to the royal kingdom of God. So, as an inheritance of their father Abraham, for about 450 years. After that, he gave them judges because they could not resolve the problem themselves. As Moses tried to help the two fighting people, you know, he had told them, oh, let me help you. Don't fight. The aggressor said, we know how to do it. We don't need your help. At that time, they were sensible enough. But when they become not sensible, then judges are sent out when the unrighteousness prevails. Themselves, as Moses tried to help them resolve until the time of the prophet Samuel. So seems to be the prophet Samuel time, the people were not intelligent enough to resolve the issues themselves. So they needed some judges and also the law on a stronger basis. So judges only appear when there's a law to apply. No law to apply, no judges. Then they asked for a king, and God gave them Saul, son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, who reigned for 40 years. When he had removed him, he made David their king, David of Judah tribe. In his testimony about him, he said, I have found David, son of Jesse, to be a man after my heart, who will carry out all my wishes. David was a righteous person. He was what we call angel or devta. So, of this man's posterity, God has brought to Israel a Saviour, Jesus, the son of Yahweh, or the firstborn of Yahweh, the second Adam, because the people of Judah tribe had become unfaithful to Abraham and Yahweh, the super bastard fanatic devils. They had become super bastard fanatic devils, John 8 verse 44. And his name is, Jesus' name, Hebrew name is YaShiva. YaShiva stands for Yah from Yahweh, and Shua means Adam. YaShiva. Yahweh, Shiva, primal Adam. As he promised, before his coming, John the Baptist, the last prophet on earth, in the name of Elijah. Elijah means my God is Yahweh. That means he is worshipping Yahweh. The potter had already proclaimed a baptism of repentance to the Jewish people only, who had become Jews of appearance, like this turban and beard doesn't make you sick. And if a person call himself a Sikh, of the turban and beard, but he can't preach gospel, then he's a super donkey. So who had become Jews of appearance are outwardly instead of spiritually inwardly, thereby became unfaithful to their own tribal fathers. You remember that this is a tribal self, Judah tribe. People have Judah tribe. I belong to Jat tribe. Now, if I call myself Sikh as outwardly, then I say bye-bye to my Jat tribe. There are people born of the prostitutes. They don't know their father. I know my father, but by replacing my Jat tribe with Sikh tribe, Sikh has qaum, our tribe, I say bye-bye to my Jat tribe. I become self-made bastard, which is called super bastard fanatic devils. And that is what happened when the people became Jew outwardly, not inwardly. Remember, Paul said, a Jew is one who is inwardly spiritual and not outwardly tribal. But when they become tribal, they become super bastard fanatic devils. That is why Jesus took a virgin birth among them, because he did not want to be born of the fanatic devils. Instead of spiritual, thereby became unfaithful to their own tribal fathers, Abraham and Yahweh, who planted them in the area, in this area. Yahweh planted them in this area, and that was Abraham and his sons, not those who are not his sons. Are all the promised people of Israel. And as John was finishing his work by baptizing them in the name of Abraham, the very name that the temple priest hated, and for that reason they killed angel Stephen, who urged them to be faithful to Abraham. And for this reason, John the Baptist called them a brood of vipers. He said, What do you suppose that I am? I am not he, the Messiah, Christ Jesus, but one is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of the sandals of his feet, because he is the second Adam himself. Whilst John the Baptist was working for the first mythological Adam that nobody has seen. It's a mythological, not real. I can tell you many things, but no customers. Never mind, we are in the tribulation period and the atomic war is expected. Is expected on May 14, 2023, when Israel shall be 75 years old. This is how it will happen. Israel was established on 14 May 1948. Give 70 years of protection as the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. 70 is made of 7 times 10, 7 types of works, and times 10 are the 10 commandments of Moses. If anyone knows the exact date of destruction of the temple, I would much appreciate. By this time, there will be a mass movement of the Jews outwardly. Of the Jews outwardly of appearance, you know. Towards Israel. in which the Jews of Semitic race, especially of the Semitic race, you know, Semitic race, they are not white, they are not black, because Semitic race is a mix of white and Negro race, Aryan and Negro. So Semitic race would be bundled up. Matthew 13, verse 24 to 30. It says that they are the tares, you know, unfaithful to Abraham, unfaithful to Yahweh. They will be bundled up in Israel for the final burning. Then Israel would suffer attacks from the circumcised Gentile, the fake sons of Abraham. Circumcised, you remember that when the Jewish people, these Messianic Jews, they entered into the fold of Muhammad. Then they brought in their Jewish practices, which was circumcision. Then kosher is same as halal. And then kippah on their small cap, which is same thing as Jewish one. So they bring in, which these things they could not bring into the Church of God, headed by Christ Jesus. But into the Mohammedan fold they bring in. So they made them the fake sons of Abraham. Remember that circumcision is the tribal mark of Abraham to Isaac only, and not to Ishmael, a son born of the slave woman, concubine. The greedy temple priest created these fake sons of Abraham, and angel Stephen warned them of the end results, but they killed him. Angel Stephen told them, you know, don't make fake sons of Abraham. They will kill you at the end. And that is what is going to happen. People, they are Aryan race, for example, in Iran. And India, Pakistan, they have nothing to do with Semitic race. So they will be the one who will be a staunch enemies. And they will kill them. It's their own making. Nobody told them to make fake sons of Abraham. They made it, and they have to face the consequences. So our Father God bless you. I hope you enjoy this video, and I can preach gospel is as simple as ABC. It comes from your heart. Everything is settled in your heart. From heart you preach gospel, it is become a rivulet of living water. So our Father God bless you.